continue worshiping together in prayer, turning in our serene to page 15. Reshit Chachma Yirat Yerua Seheruto Lechol Sehen Tehilato Omenet Lachat Vehu Rahum Yechaper Hom Velo Yashmit Vehirbat Vehashivako Velo Yadir Kol Chamato. The fear of the Yerua is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do thereafter. His praise endures forever, and he, being merciful, forgives iniquity and does not destroy. Frequently he turns away his anger and does not stir up all his wrath. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not do the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. לא היכול לשמרכם בלי מכשול ולהעמידכם בלי מום לפני תפארתו בשמחה אשר הוא לבדו האלוהים בו שאינו ביד ישיו המשיח אלוהינו הכבוד והשלטון והעיקה והגדולה בטרם מכל עולם אתה ובכל העולמים. אמן. And unto him who is able to preserve you faultless and spotless and to establish you without a blemish before his majesty with joy, namely the only Elohim, our Savior, by means of Yeshua HaMashiach, our Master, be praise and dominion and honor and majesty, both now and in all the ages. Amen. Veshamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat, la'asot et ha-Shabbat le'olotam brit olam. Veni v'nei Yisrael oti le'olam. Ki sheshet yamin asa yi'evola et ha-Shamayim ve'et ha-Aretz, uvayom ha-Shaviti, Shabbat ve'yamash. The children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations, as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever, that in 6 days Yahweh made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he ceased from work and rested. Amen. Great mercy, Elohim, answer me with the truth of your salvation. Page 57. Kadosh, 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 Yerva Elohim Sevaot, Haya Ehove Ve'Yihye. Lecha Na'e Adoneinu Ve'Eloheinu, Laset Kvod Ve'Hadar Ma'oz, Ki Ata Ve'Ata Hakol, Ve'Kol Ve'Tzonecha, Hayu Ve'Nivaru. Holy, holy, holy is Yerva Elohim Sevaot, one who was, who is coming. You are worthy, Adoneinu, Eloheinu, have glory, honor, and power, because you created all things. Yes, because of your will they were created and came into being. And they shouted out, worthy is the slaughtered lamb to receive power, riches, wisdom, strength, honor, glory, and praise. And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth, under the earth and on the sea, yes, everything in them, saying, to the one sitting on the throne and to the lamb belong praise and honor, glory and power forever and ever. Praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great. Amen. Baruch ata, Yehovah, Eloheinu, Melech haolam, asher natan lanu et derech ha'yeshuva b'mashiach yeshuva. Blessed are you, Yehovah, our Elohim, King of the universe, who has given us a way of salvation in Messiah Yeshua. He walked among us filled with the Ruach, the only one who ever fulfilled your Torah. He healed the sick and raised the dead. The multitudes of our people sought his touch. He taught as no man taught. With authority he brought forth the treasures of the Torah. How the children sought him, the lepers he touched and made clean. How the despised and outcast found love and relief from their sin. How the hypocrites feared him whose words uncovered their sin. Despised and rejected, acquainted with grief, he bore the sins of Israel. All we like sheep have gone astray, turned everyone to his own way. Our iniquities were laid upon the king, the sins of the world his burden to bear. He rose from the dead and opened the way to life everlasting. Praise his name, we are in him, his ruach empowers. New life is ours with joy and peace. Blessed are you, O Yehovah, our Elohim, King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua, our King. Baruch atah, Yehovah, Eloheinu, Melech haolam, asher natan lanu Mashiach Yeshua, our King. Amen. Ein kamocha Elohim, Yehovah, ve'ein kemaasecha, ma'alchotecha malchut kol olamim, u'memshalatecha lechal dor vador. Yeruah Melech, Yeruah Malach, Yeruah Yimloch Meolam Vaed, Yeruah Oseho, Yiten Yeruah Yerech Et Amor Vashalom. There is none like you among the gods, Yeruah, and there is nothing that compares to your deeds. Your kingdom is a kingdom that endures for all eternity, and your sovereignty extends throughout all generations. Yeruah reigns, Yeruah has reigned. Yahweh will reign throughout eternity. Yahweh will bless his people with peace. Abrahamim hedeva v'rtzonecha etzion kibnechovot Yerushalayim kibechal labad matachnu melech el ram yalisa adon olamim. Father of compassion, reveal kindly to Zion according to your will. Rebuild the walls of Yerushalayim, for we trust in you alone, O King, revered and honored Elohim, master of the entire universe. Vayehi Yitzho Aharon Vayomer Moshe Kuna Yehova Ve'afutsu Oyedecha Ve'anusu Mesenecha Mipenecha Ki Zion Tesei Torah Ular Yehova Yerushalayim Baruch Shenatan Torah Ve'arom Yisrael Mikirushato. When the ark went forward, Moshe would say, arise, O Yehovah, let your enemies be scattered. Let those who hate you flee from before you. For from Zion shall go forth the Torah and the word of Yehovah from Yerushalayim. Blessed is he who in holiness gave the Torah to his people, Israel. Amen. Ki Zion Tetzei Torah. Ki Zion Tetzei Torah.
Page 62. Mi sheberach avotenu Avraham Yitzchak veYaakov hu yeberech et matetyahu she'allah lichvod hamakom velichvod hatorah. Hakadosh baruch hu yishmorehu veyatzilehu mikal tzara v'tzuka umikal nega umachala veyishlach beracha v'chatzlacha machal ma'aseh yadav. Amen. May he who blessed our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, may he bless Matt, who has come up to honor this place and to honor the Torah. May the Holy One bless him, protect him, and deliver him from all tribulation and oppression, and from every plague and illness. And may he send blessing and prosperity on all the work of his hands. Amen.
Adonai ha-mevorach le'olam v'ayed. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech ha'olam, asher bachar banu mikol ha'amim, v'natan lanu et Torato. Baruch atah Adonai, noten ha-Torah. Amen. I will be reading from Shemot 30:22-32. Moreover, Yahweh spoke unto Moshe, saying, Take also unto you the chief spices of flowing myrrh, 500 shekels, and of sweet cinnamon, half so much, even 250, and of sweet calumet, 250, and of cassia, 500, after the shekel of the sanctuary, and of olive oil a hin, and you shall make it a kadosh anointing oil, a perfume compounded after the hour of the perfumer. It shall be a kodesh anointing oil, and you shall anoint therewith the ohel moed, and the aron ha'idut, and the shulchan, and all the vessels thereof, and the menorah, and the vessels thereof, and the mitzbeach of incense, and the mitzbeach ha'olah, with all the vessels thereof, and the kior and the base thereof, and you shall sanctify them, that they may be kodesh kodeshim. Whatever touches them shall be kodesh, and you shall anoint Aharon and his sons, and sanctify them, that they may minister unto me in the Kohen's office. And you shall speak unto the Bnei Israel, saying, this shall be the Shemin Mishchat Kodesh unto me throughout your generations. Upon the flesh of man it shall not be poured, neither shall you make any like it. According to the composition thereof, it is Kodesh, and it shall be Kodesh unto you.
Amen.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu et Torah emet, v'chaye olam atah betochenu. Baruch atah Adonai, noten haTorah. Amen. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who selected good prophets, abiding their words, which were spoken truthfully. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, who chose the Torah, and the servant Moshe, and the people Israel, and the prophets of truth and righteousness.
Amen. I'll be reading from Melachim Aleph, 18:36-39. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening offering, that Eliyahu Hanavi came near and said, O Yahweh, the Elohim of Abraham, of Yitzchak, and of Israel, let it be known this day that you are Elohim in Israel, and that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Hear me, O Yahweh, hear me, that this people may know you, that you, Yahweh, are Elohim, for you did not turn their heart backward. Then the fire of Yahweh fell and consumed the burnt offering and the wood and the stones and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces. And they said, Yahweh, he is Elohim. Yahweh, he is Elohim.
Amen.
Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, rock of all ages, righteous throughout all generations. You are the faithful God, promising and then performing, first speaking and then fulfilling, for all your words are true and righteous. Faithful are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, and faithful are your words, for no word of yours shall remain unfulfilled. You are a faithful and merciful Elohim and King. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, who are faithful in fulfilling all your words. Have mercy on Zion, it is the fountain of our life, and very soon deliver her who grieves deeply. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, who makes Zion rejoice with her children, and make us joyful, O Yahweh, our Elohim, with the prophet Eliyahu, your servant, and with the kingdom of the house of David, your anointed. May Eliyahu come soon and bring joy to our hearts. Allow no stranger to sit on David's throne or inherit his glory. For by your holy name, you swore to him that his light would not be quenched forever. Blessed are you, O Yahweh, the shield of David. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu Mashiach Yeshua, behavarim shelim ha'hadasha. Baruch atah Adonai, notin pri chadasha. Amen.
I am reading from Corinthians 3:1-3. Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or do we need, as some others do, epistles of commendation concerning us written to you, or that you should write commending us? You are our epistle, written in our hearts, well known and read by all men. For you are known to be the epistle of Mashiach, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Ruah of the living Elohim, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of the heart of flesh.
Amen.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu devar emet, v'chayei olam tablets of stone. Baruch atah Adonai, noten brit hachadishah. Amen. This is the Torah which Moshe placed before the children of Israel. It is in the core of the command of Yahweh by the hand of Moshe. A tree of life it is for those who take hold of it, and blessed are the ones who support it. Its ways are ways of pleasantness, and all its paths are peace. Long life is in its right hand, and its death are riches and honor. Yahweh was pleased for the sake of his righteousness to render the Torah great and glorious. Amen.
You may be seated, and today is Matthew's portion, so he's going to give us a drash. So give him a big hand.
Well, I've been preparing for this for like a year and a half, so it's like probably like the 10th set of notes that I didn't boil up. So I figured I'll leave the complicated stuff to him, and I'll just bring the little stuff that I seen. The first part that jumped out to me is when Abba declared who he was to Moses, when he said, Yahweh, Yahweh, merciful and compassionate. And he also spoke about how there's blessing and then there's cursing there, but the curses fall on your children. And it wasn't until I had my daughter where I really thought about, you know, I'm either blessed or curse my family by my actions. So, like, as a father, that, you know, that jumped out to me. So, you know, starting off there, I seen how it talks about the sons of Aaron washing their hands and their feet before they entered the tent of meeting. And that brought me to, you know, in Proverbs, it talks about hands that shed innocent blood and feet quick to do evil are abominations in Abba's sight. And my younger days, you know, I used to be in the crowd in the Navy and stuff like that, you know, especially in boot camp when somebody start messing up. You know, and instead of showing them mercy, you know, as soon as RDC leave, we'd jump them. You know, so it was very convicting, you know, once you start, you know, delving into this Torah portion. Also, another thing, they had to make sure that, you know, their intentions was pure and, you know, how they was handling their business, you know, was correct before they went in to offer the incense. Revelation talks about our prayers being incense, you know, so. I mean, I figure if your intentions have not been pure and, you know, what you've been up to all day has been wicked, you know, your prayer don't smell like incense, but it smells like throw up. I mean, that's just the way I looked at it. So the second thing, you know, it seems like in this Torah portion, everything's like black and white. It's just either all the way wrong or you're all the way right. And So in Terumah, which is my wife's portion, you seen where they took up a collection for Abba, you know, to build his house. And this one, they took up a collection, you know, to get the party started, basically. And so, like, it says, like, they took all the gold out, you know, their heirs and other things, and they built the calf with it because I guess they lost their patience when Moses was taking all day to come down from the mountain. Well, or a month, 2 months, month and a half, I don't know. And so the thing that jumped out to me about that was, well, for one, I need to have more patience because I always want things done real quick. So that was convicting. also, I looked up calf, and the root word of that, I think it's agal, and it means like round, like, I guess, I don't know, circle, or I don't know, he knows. I'm not going to delve into that, but... like when you have a wrong leader, you're gonna start chasing your tail, because like Torah wants us to go straight forward, you know, to not turn to the left or the right. So here, you know, they put the calf up, they actually went around this calf, you know, drunk, doing a bunch of wicked things, and you know, judgment came down upon them for that. So I guess what we can learn from that, What are you spending your money on? Are you taking up a collection, you know, for Abba or for wickedness? And if you are, you know, that's the idolatry that's in your life. You know, Yeshua said, where your treasure is, your heart will be also. So that's something that jumped out to me about that. Trying to hurry up. I guess I'm going to end this with basically just my story of how I came to Messianic Judaism. My dad is actually a pastor, and the name of the church was Tree of Life Bible Church. We grew up Baptist, but then we went non-denominational, and he always told me, if somebody can't prove it to you from the Bible, then, you know, don't believe it. So that stuck with me. As I got older, I started partying like most people. And yeah, and I got convicted. So, you know, you go back to what you're used to. I wanted to go back to the church. So I was going to a Kajic church for a while. Didn't agree with too much of the doctrine there. So I started praying about a new place to go. And at the time, my apartment was on the street in San Diego called El Cajon Boulevard. And El Cajon, that name is Spanish, it means the box. So as I'm walking up El Cajon, which is a street full of like Catholicism, other churches, prostitution, you name it, everything's on this street. So I'm walking up the street. I didn't realize that it was the Ruach lead me up the street, because I don't walk nowhere. So, you know, I'm just walking and I don't realize why I'm walking. So I get sidetracked by this church. I joined there for a year. Had I not known at the time, if I had walked one more block, I would have walked right into Tree of Life Messianic Congregation. So I got sidetracked like the people did, dancing around, you know, the calf. I stayed there for a year, you know, went back to Afghanistan. And there I met this Jamaican dude that was Jewish. And he was asking me if I believed in Yeshua. I told him I did. He was not a believer in Yeshua. And I couldn't argue with him because I didn't know anything about the Torah. So that caused me to get on Wikipedia like most people. So I'm like, I got something for old on Wikipedia. So I look on Wikipedia and then I read about Messianic Judaism. And I'm like, oh, I didn't know Jews believed in Jesus. So I seen Jews for Jesus and I started donating to them from there, from the internet. And then I came home. As soon as my deployment's over, I'm back on El Cajon Boulevard, back to my apartment. I'm in the box again. So this time I'm washing my car. And I look to my left, and I notice this congregation. And just something, just I couldn't shake my sight from it. So after I finished washing my car, I got on the street, and then I saw him go look at it. So it ended up being a synagogue, and it was on the corner of El Cajon and 70th Street. So I turned, I shooved from the box, basically. And, you know, I went over there and I looked at it. And it said, it's Chaim Messianic Congregation, Tree of Life Messianic Congregation. So, and the Messianic rabbi there, his name is Joel. I looked up that name. That name means Yahweh is Elohim. So, I mean, summing all this up, had I not listened to the Ruach, I would have stayed in a box of Catholicism and a bunch of other stuff, you know, that I was confused about. So it's like Abba showed me all throughout this Torah, like names have meaning. Always look at the meaning of the names and stuff here, even in your own life. I think me and Deanne was talking about something she seen on the side of a building that brought her back to something in scripture. I'm gonna top this off with just, when Abba showed Moshe who he was, he actually brought him up into the mountain. And it wasn't until he stood on a place near him, on a rock near him, that he seen, you know, Abba's footsteps, where he could walk in his ways, like directly behind him. So, I mean, just from this, I learned that if we are not like walking on Torah, if we're not walking in Torah and standing on the rock, because the Ten Commandments and the Torah was written on the rock, then we can't stand behind, you know, Abba. And so, you know, Yeshua said, build your house on the rock, you know, and it just jumped out to me. Everything's black and white. There's no gray areas with Elohim. So I'm going to stop there. Oh, yeah, one more thing. I love everybody. I agree with the halakha here, you know, and I'm glad to be here. I'll cut for any one of y'all. That's it.
Amen. Thank you, Matadiau. Good job. Shabbat Shalom. It's very rare that on the first day of the week when I start reading the Torah portion that I know immediately what Abba wants me to speak about. But that happened this week. And something that has never happened before is that I woke up at 2 o'clock this morning and finished my drash. It's 15 pages long. So I don't know how long we're going to be here. But I know that this is very, very important to this body for several reasons. Because of what we are about to do as a body together, which is a very big challenge, and it will challenge our character as a body. But more than that, some spiritual things that are going on in the body that most of you probably aren't aware of. I think some of you are spiritually. Our senior members can kind of tell when the body is coming under attack, when the body is suffering, and that's the nature of being part of a messianic body, is that it's alive and you feel other people's pain and you don't know sometimes what that pain is. So what I'm going to do first, basically my message is in two parts, and I'm going to look first at sort of the elements of the tabernacle, because we've been reading about the preparation for building of the tabernacle. So we're going to look at those things first and see what do these things represent for us, because they're not just things. And I talked about that a couple of weeks ago, how Elohim personified these inanimate objects. Do you remember that? So I'm going to break down these elements that are the first part of our portion actually goes over. And so the first one is, and the second part of what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about the Ruach HaKodesh. Okay? That's going to be interwoven through this first part as well, and hopefully you'll see what I'm talking about. So the first thing that we're going to look at is the Kesef HaKippurim, the atonement money. This is a price that was to be paid by every Israelite of age, and it was an equal price. Everyone had to pay the same price in order to make atonement for himself and his family. This alludes to Messiah atoning for everyone. There's no one in here whose atonement is greater than the next person. Are you with me? Messiah did this to bring us into the kingdom, to bring us into his Beit HaMikdash, into his temple, into his house. And that has already happened. And it took atonement for every person to get there. What is atonement? It's a covering over of what's underneath the atonement element. In this case, it's the blood of Messiah. Are you with me? The Kiyor Nechoshet, the brass laver, is a sea, a basin in which the priesthood washes before they come into the Ohel Moed, the tent of meeting. This is also a picture of Messiah who washes anyone who follows him. On the night of the Passover, Yeshua made it a point to wash his Talmudim, the feet of his Talmudim, to demonstrate to them what he was about to do in the spiritual. So he physically washed them to get their hearts ready for the fact that they needed to be washed. And he told Kepha, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. You cannot be my disciple if I do not wash you. One of the reasons that we don't do foot washings, other than the fact that we don't wear sandals everywhere we go today, is because it takes your mind off of the fact that it's Yeshua who is to wash you. Are you with me? How does he wash us then? Obviously, it's first by our confession of trust in the fact that we need his blood to cleanse us from our sins. But then we have to continually wash, and that's what this basin is a picture of. The priesthood is set apart, and then they are washed, and then they are dressed, and then they are anointed, and then they begin to perform their duties. And then when they amble about in the sanctuary, within the boundaries of the sanctuary, before they go back into the tent, they have to wash again. You are going to need washing for the rest of your life. That's why it's tevilah. It's multiple immersions that we teach in this congregation. There's more than one washing. Okay? How does Yeshua wash us today? It's by obedience to his commandments. It's by us recognizing that the word says there are things that we should do and there are things that we should not do. And when we do the things that we should not do, we need to be washed. When we do not do the things that we should do, we need to be washed. And growing in Messiah is being able to recognize what those things are and responding and being obedient and washing again. By applying the commandment to your life, by confessing the blood of Messiah, by changing, by turning, by fixing your walk. The next thing is the Shemen Mishchat Kodesh, the holy oil for anointing. And this is what set me on the path of this message, this anointing oil. This particular oil was used to set aside, to make holy, to sanctify all of the vessels in the tabernacle and the priests. This was an oil that had perfumes in it, spices in it, to make it have a scent that was very unique. And if you get an oil from Israel today, they still obey the commandment not to make this oil for anything but the Beit HaMikdash. So it'll only have one or two of the spices in it, usually two, but never all. And any variation of it is a beautiful smell. Am I right? Have you? It's beautiful. I can't wait to smell the real thing on the robe of Messiah. But as Matthew pointed out, the incense is made up of some of the same spices, and that's the prayers. But what this is the anointing for the priesthood, which is a picture of the Ruach HaKodesh. Psalm 133 is one of my favorite psalms. I think it's Kelly's favorite psalm. How good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. It is like the oil running down on the head of Aaron, running over his beard, going down his garment, flowing down onto the ground. It is like the dew of Hermon flowing from that mountain way up in North Israel, going all the way through to the river of Jordan, going all the way through the land of Israel. It is the priesthood. That's what this anointing is for. And it was never to be put on someone who was not a priest. Did you notice that it said, don't put it on mankind? I believe that this is an allusion to who you and I are. We are not ordinary men. We are not supposed to be like all other men. Every human being who is in the sound of my voice right now, if you belong to Messiah Yeshua, you are a priest. And you have been anointed. Are you with me? So many people are seeking, I need the anointing. I need the anointing. Confess the name of Yeshua. You have the anointing. That's what makes us distinct from every other human being, and it should make us so unique as a group of people that it perplexes other people why we are so different. And that's the goal of this congregation. And so when things happen where human behaviors prevail over spiritual maturity, it really frustrates us in the leadership. It frustrates me. When we're having to deal with petty little things that children do, coming out of adults who sit and listen, theoretically, to the Torah every week. It should not be. It should be that everyone in here recognizes the sanctity of the blood that anointed you. That's what the word Mashiach means. Messianic. Anointed ones. We are supposed to have this oil, this anointing, that is a sweet aroma to everyone around us and that makes us intercessors in the house of Elohim. Again, we become anointed like this because of the death of Messiah, because of our confession in his death and in his resurrection. And while Messiah died for the whole world is not set apart. Not until each individual makes a confession is anyone set apart. Are you with me? The next thing in the Beit HaMikdash, or in the tent of meeting, is the Ketoret. And that's the incense. And it is an incense unto Yahuwah. And it too is symbolic of Messiah, but particularly, like Matthew pointed out, it's symbolic of prayers. And in the book of Revelation, he brought it up. In the book of Revelation, there is a verse that actually says that we, who are assembled around the throne, will hold bowls or cups in our hand, and it will contain incense, which are the prayers of the Kadoshim. Okay, so the incense represents our prayers. And he was exactly right. I hope our prayers don't smell like what he said they smell like. There's several places in the Brit Chadashah where Shaul says that your offerings and prayers, one of your offerings, are a sweet incense unto Abba. And they should be. So now we're going to look at the power of the Ruach in the building of the Ohel Moed, the tent of meeting. After all these elements that I just talked about are described, which are for all for the purpose of making the sanctuary set apart, Kodesh, Tamim, pure, then we see that in the case of the tabernacle, very particular people were to be anointed to do the work of building the tabernacle. And so in Shemot, Exodus, I believe it's chapter 31, it says, Bezalel ben Uri ben Hur lemate Yehuda. Matthew also pointed out that Hebrew names have meaning. And you can't get any more obvious with the intent of what this guy was doing than what this name, that whole string of words that I just read, is his name. It's his proper name. It's what you would see on a contract were he to sign it. Bezalel means in the shadow or image, shape, form of Elohim. Ben Uri means son of my light. Ben Hur means son of whiteness or brightness or fine linen. You should know what that's alluding to, especially if you've participated in the Torah study with us. Mate Yehuda means the staff of Yehuda, which is a picture of the Messiah. And when Messiah, before he left the earth, what did he say? Hine, behold, I go to build a place for you. And so this is what Yaakov said when he was standing in Israel and they were discussing what to do with the Goyim, the Gentiles, who were coming into this faith, and there were false brothers teaching them that they had to be circumcised to be saved. That's a conversion process. Yaakov, the brother of Yeshua, stands up and says, or it may have been Kepha who said this, brothers, this is what was prophesied. We are building the fallen tent, Ohel of David. Messiah went up into Hashemayim just like Moshe did. Moshe's up there. He's up in the mountain getting all this information. Are you with me? Moshe is up there by himself getting all this information about how to build the tabernacle, and now he's being told to anoint specific people to do the job. He's up there receiving the message about what to do. And I've got something to tackle about that. And the name of the person is an allusion to Messiah, who has gone up before us 2,000 years ago and has been building his tabernacle, if you will, for the last 2,000 years. Bezalel is filled with the Ruach. I want you to understand this. It didn't say he was somewhat filled with the Ruach, or he was halfway filled with the Ruach. Are you with me? He was filled with the Ruach. The Ruach of Elohim was poured out upon him, and it says he was filled with Chachma, Binah, Da'at, and Malacha. Now, Chachma, Binah, Vada'at, you should know, because I've taught it multiple times. Chachma, Binah, and Da'at. Number two, number three, and number six. They are powers of the Ruach HaKodesh that are listed in Isaiah 11:2 that are alluded to in Revelation chapter 4. I want you to catch this. Here is a man who is filled with the Ruach, and he only has three of the five powers that are on that menorah, other than the very Ruach of Yahweh himself, which is number one. And number seven is the fear of Yahweh. And those you have to have. Yeah, everybody. But everything else that other people call gifts of the Spirit, that they try to make lists about, they come from these five right here. And Bezalel has three of them. Yet he is filled with the Ruach. What am I getting at? Not everyone is going to move in all the powers of the Ruach HaKodesh. You are all different. You're all chosen for different purposes in the house of Elohim. Not everybody is going to speak in tongues. Not everybody is going to prophesy. Not everybody is going to have knowledge. Only whoever Yeshua determines to use for a particular place in his congregation, that's all he's going to give that person, and you can't do anything about it. Quit trying to stuff tongues in people's mouths. I saw you, Kelly. He thought sitting way over there would make me leave him alone. Bezalel was not given Ruach Etzah or Ruach Gevorah. He was anointed with three very important powers of the Ruach HaKodesh, and then also given Malacha, which is skill, which is physical workmanship, the ability to produce something. Okay? And it was for particular purposes. And then we have Oholiab. And that name means the tent of my father, and he's from the tribe of Dan, the son of judgment, if you will. There's more to his name that I didn't put in here, but he is given only Chachma, wisdom. And he and a bunch of other people were given Chachma, but in the same way they were filled with the Ruach, only this time it's only Chachma. So Elohim comes to the lamp that represents Chachma, which is this guy right here. He lights it, and he dabs it on this guy and fills him up with it. Do you see that? Yeshua, and I've taught this over and over, had every bit of every power of the Ruach HaKodesh there ever could be. Every tiny flame, all of it. Are you getting what I'm driving at? Only he ever walked like that. That's why this thing is divided, to show us that we each have our own lamp and a very particular role in the congregation. Oholiab is given only Chachma, wisdom. That's a step up from Binah, or understanding, and it's a step up from Da'at. In other words, you can't have understanding until you get knowledge, and you can't have wisdom until you get understanding. Are you with me? Wisdom uses knowledge and understanding and applies it to a situation to make beauty where there is none. An example of this is when Shlomo, Solomon, is in this situation where there are two harlots in his presence fighting over an infant. And he has to figure out how to expose the liar. He knows one of them is lying. And he uses wisdom and he understands that a mother would never harm her baby. A mother would never take the child away from his mother or away from his... Are you with me? A mother would never harm. So he feeds on that instinct that that whoever the mother is should have, and he exposes it. And it was beautiful because that baby lived because of this. A lot of people look at that and look at... Humanity looks at the negative and sees the ugly. Are you with me? Shlomo looked at this and he knew that it would produce life and beauty in this. And that child got to grow up in the care of his mother and not be robbed of his real mother and not die. So these men are gifted with these powers, and they were to make all of the vessels that were talked about when Moshe is up there getting the instructions on what to build and how to build it. And then, before the work commences, in other words, after all of this is laid out, the last thing he says is, keep my Sabbaths. And it's in that little piece of the scripture where we get Veshamru, one of my favorite songs, one of my favorite prayers, Veshamru v'nei Yisrael et HaShabbat. The children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath because it is a perpetual sign throughout their generations. Right? So it's interesting to me that this portion has right in the middle of it, right after all of these instructions are given, keep my Sabbath. That's what the tabernacle was built for. That was the day of regular assembly, was Shabbat, the seventh day. Then we have an episode of the golden calf. I want you to catch this. So before they even begin work on the sanctuary, and Matt cracked me up, they took up an offering to have a party. Moshe is up there getting instructions, and they're down here already turning away. Moshe's up there getting the news that he is going to anoint people with power to build the very house of Elohim, and those people are down there in folly and in sin. I've read this many, many times over the course of my life, but this just never stood out at me the way it did this time. He calls out Bezalel and Aholiab. And in all likelihood, Moshe gets an understanding of who else is anointed to do this job. And they're down there monkeying around. And how do we know these guys participated in the wrong stuff? Because when Moshe came down from the mountain and heard all the stuff going on, and he tells Yehoshua, it's not the noise of war. These guys are up to something, and it ain't good. And he gets down there and he says, whoever is on the side of Yahweh, come to me. And only the Levites come to him. Bezalel was from Yehuda and Oholiab was from Dan. I want you to understand this. They had just been given divine appointment to build a tabernacle, and they helped build a golden calf. Are you with me? The same it is for you and me. Messiah dies in our place, ascends up into heaven, starts preparing to build his sanctuary, and we're down here messing it up, mucking it up, making cows. Then we see this odd verse in the middle of that. Vayitnatzelu v'nei Yisrael et ediyam mehar choref. And this is in 33. So after all of that, and they're rebuked, and 3,000 people die, and the Levi'im are set apart, After all of that, then in verse 6 of chapter 33, it says, the B'nai Yisrael, the sons of Yisrael, and the way it literally reads is, delivered themselves of their ornaments from Mount Horeb onward. This should stick out at us because it's one of those verses that are just kind of odd. And if you know anything about Hebrew, you know that yitnatzelu, if you're listening, you can hear natsal in it. The natsal is the escape that is foreshadowed. So, but what are they doing? They are delivering themselves of their ornaments. What ornaments? Dressing, walking like an Egyptian, dressing like an Egyptian, acting like... I knew somebody would go there. But all the 80s kids went there. They stripped themselves of their worldly ornaments, of their attire, the things that made them look like everybody else. I made a note here, and I'm going to go ahead and read it. If you're dressing and adorning yourself to attract people to you, that's probably one of the reasons that your prayer life is not going skyward. Because you're too interested in getting attention from people around you. You should be dressing to attract God's attention and to please Him. So then we see Moshe praying in his tent, and we see that when he prayed and the Anan, the pillar of cloud, came down and rested over his tent, and Yahuwah spoke to him at the door of his tent. And when he did that, everyone else, all the men of the camp, stood in the doorway of their own tent and bowed and prayed. This is what we see at the end of our service every week. When we do the blessing. Are you with me? There's a reason why we do everything that we do. And so what this tells you is that sanctity in a religious worship is absolutely necessary. It should not make it seem boring. If you're just there because you've been dragged in, I suppose it's boring. But if you're here because you want to worship Elohim, then you understand that sanctity produces the presence of Elohim. He honors us when we honor Him. Now I want to focus on the Ruach HaKodesh. I've only got 10 pages left. We read in our portion, upon the flesh of man shall it not be poured, neither shall you make any like it. According to the composition thereof, it is Kodesh, and it shall be Kodesh to you. This is going to be a tricky thing, a tricky message for me to bring to this congregation, because you may not see it like I see it. But there is so much false anointing in the world. And sadly, it gets brought into here. There is so much false anointing and made up gifts of the Spirit. And you mark my words. Someone in this room is probably going to fall prey to it again in the future. When Yeshua talked about the last days, when his Talmudim came to him and asked him about the last days, every single time that he does, he says, beware that you not be deceived. Because the whole job of Hasatan is he's a counterfeit. He knows how to look like Messiah. He knows how to make you think that you're in his presence when you're actually in the presence of Hasatan. When you're actually in the presence of falseness and trickery and deceit, and you're being dragged into something that is not truth. And don't think for a moment that anyone sitting in here is not susceptible to it, including me. We're all susceptible to it. Hasatan would love to destroy this congregation, and I promise you he is doing his dead level best to destroy us. And if you were to sit and listen to the history of this congregation that my wife and I and some of the old people in here have been through, you would know what I'm talking about is truth. Over and over and over, Hasatan brings false junk in here and false people in here. And not only that, but you go out on the internet, and I promise you, 99.99% of that is garbage. And I see it on your Facebook pages. And I'm sitting there trying to go, oh my gosh. I'm debating in my mind, do I name? Not our people who are doing it, but the names of the people that you're posting things from that are false teachers.
They posted them public.
Many will come in my name and deceive many, Yeshua said. One of the things, one of the biggest ways where people do that, come in Yeshua's name and deceive people, is by pretending to be a prophet. And they have a false anointing. They're building a pseudo house of God, just like the two northern tribes did, Ephraim and Dan. They built a house, and they called it by the name of Yah, and they worshiped, did some of the Jewish stuff in it. But dadgummit, there was a cow sitting in the middle of that house. They pretend to have the power of Elohim. And I want you to understand something. The Ruach of Elohim, the power of Elohim, is not measured by miracles. It is not. The Sheker HaMashiach, the false Messiah, is coming to do miracles, to make people believe that he is the Messiah. And so don't think that his false messiahs are not out there now doing that very thing. You cannot measure the Ruach HaKodesh by someone speaking in tongues. For one thing, I've seen it over and over. There's a lot of shandai rondai, and I know I'm being facetious. Could have bought a Kia, but I bought a Honda. There's a lot of that out there where people are just making up the gifts of the Ruach and pretending. And if you're not keen and aware and if you don't have the word, this thing down inside of you, it will deceive you. Miracles are child's play to God. Making you talk in tongues is no big deal to him. Look at the creation. Whoop-de-doo, you spoke a language. These things, these powers of the Spirit, they're only miracles to us because we're human beings. The biggest miracle to God, you want to know what heaven rejoices over? Yeshua told us twice what heaven rejoices over. I'm going to read it to you. What man among you has 100 sheep, and if one of them should get lost, would he not leave the 99 and in the open and go in search of the one which is lost until he finds it? And when he finds it, he rejoices and takes it on his shoulders, and he comes to his house, and he invites his friends and neighbors and says to them, rejoice with me, for I have found one sheep which was lost. This is Yeshua speaking. I say to you that such will be the joy in heaven over one sinner who repents. That's what makes God rejoice. Or what woman has 10 coins and should lose one of them and would not light a lamp and sweep the house and search for it carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her women, friends, and neighbors and says to them, rejoice with me. I have found one coin which was lost.
I say to you that such will be the joy before the messengers of Elohim over one sinner who comes to repentance. The power of God is mostly demonstrated over and over in people turning from their sin. That is power. Our Haftarah was about Eliyahu, mighty in the Ruach of Elohim. And we know, and Jews understand, that Eliyahu is coming back. But the problem is people are fascinated with Eliyahu coming back. They want to see the fire come out of the sky. We missed the whole point of the story that we read in the Haftarah, and that's that at the end, Israel said, Yahweh is Elohim. Yahweh is Elohim. That's the miracle. Big deal. God sent some fire and cooked the barbecue. The miracle was that Israel turned back to their God from whom they had turned. They repented. The prophecy in Malachi about Eliyahu returning was fulfilled once already in Yochanan HaMatbil. And if you look at the life of Yochanan HaMatbil, he did not one miracle. He wasn't going around calling fire out of heaven. He probably could have. This is a guy who was full of the Ruach HaKodesh right here in his mama's belly. He didn't do one miracle that you could see with your eyes. But miraculously, he turned enough people from their sins so that they would see the Messiah. And Yeshua called Yochanan HaMatbil Eliyahu, even though he wasn't physically Eliyahu. And he said, this, Yochanan, is among the prophets in heaven, this one is the greatest. Because he turned people to repentance. That was his primary mission. That's what he was sent for. And in Malachi, where it is prophesied that Eliyahu would come back, all it says that he will do is he will turn the hearts of the children, or of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers. That's all it says. And what does that mean? That means that sons will begin to obey their fathers because fathers are beginning to care about their sons. It's just like Matthew said, he became a father. And he recognized, what I do in my spiritual life affects this child for the rest of his or her life. That's the spirit of Eliyahu. I hope y'all are going to survive. Batzion does believe in the power of the Ruach. We strive. I hope that everyone in here strives daily to live in that power. But that's not done through demonstrative acts that get people's attention. It's done by you looking in yourself and saying, Elohim, I am wicked. Change me from down inside. That's the power of Elohim. That's the primary thing. That ought to be our goal. And if we were to do that, then you would see the demonstration of power after that. So the reason you want to blame Batzion for not having any miracles? Blame yourself. Fix yourself before you walk in those doors and Elohim will show up. Abba has done many miracles for Batzion. He's done little personal miracles that only the recipient of it understands and appreciates or believes in. He's healed our bodies, and we've had some powerful healings of our bodies. Not everyone who gets sick at Batzion gets healed because he's the healer, and he decides when the patient needs to be fixed and how. But he has healed us miraculously on the spot. We're just not selling it. And the interesting thing about people who are selling it, they don't go to the hospitals and sell it. He does other miracles for us, like delivering us from danger. We live in Houston. I ride a motorcycle. Abba is motivated to do these things for us because he loves us. And the problem with miracle workers is they don't love the people that they're trying to do the miracle for. They love themselves. I want the attention. I want to be able to put my name on a billboard. I want to have a mega church 9 miles high. I want to have a $40 million mansion to live in. So I'm going to go sell some miracles. It's been going on since ages past. That's the sin of Bilam. That's the sin of a guy in the Brit Chadashah who wanted to buy the Ruach HaKodesh from Kepha. We believe obedience is more important than producing miracles. So about the empowerments, what people call the gifts of the Spirit, you better look out, because a gift can be dangerous. You can get a gift and it can blow up in your face. Because Hasatan comes as an angel of light, I've already mentioned it. And he can give you, if he can counterfeit a Messiah in the future, then he can counterfeit a miracle for you. He can counterfeit a gift for you. And I'm not going to be facetious this time, but in all sincerity, I have heard false versions of the gift of tongues. Many, many times. As a matter of fact, most of what I heard, not all, I have heard real manifestations of that gift. I speak in tongues. I just don't do it here because the scriptures tell us not to. My wife speaks in tongues, and you wouldn't know it because she doesn't go around yakking about it. And she doesn't do it in here because we're instructed not to. Tim speaks in tongues, and I bet none of you would have ever guessed that. And we have leadership that do not speak in tongues. And we didn't put a litmus test on them, and we didn't stick a tongue in their mouth. We didn't demand that they do so in order to prove to us that you have the Ruach HaKodesh. Spiritual gifts are not the proof of the Ruach HaKodesh. Love, joy, peace, temperance, meekness, kindness, self-control. This is the proof of the gift of the Ruach HaKodesh. Shaul told the Corinthians, I wish that all of you spoke in tongues, but I wish better that you would prophesy. Why? Because prophecy builds up the body. Tongues builds up self. Tongues is for weak people. I'm a weak person. Tongues builds up self. And I told the men, we got on this subject in the men's class this morning, you don't speak in tongues. No one in here speaks in tongues. God does. Through you. You're not special because you speak in tongues. And you may have exercised it falsely. You may have been given it by somebody else other than God. So check yourself. So concerning prophecy, the primary role or duty of or goal of a prophet is to turn hearts to God. Amen. That is the primary role. It's not to tell the future. And trust me, there are prophets on every corner. And not just of the Christian variety. I got to thinking about it, and I just sat there for a moment, and I was thinking, I was going over the scriptures in my mind. I was just walking through, you know, I'm pretty certain about the chronology of the books, and so I'm walking through all the books of the scriptures, and I'm trying to think, what prophet ever said, I am a prophet? And there's not one. One false prophet said, I am a prophet. And it's in the book of 1 Kings, chapter 13. He was from the Northern Kingdom. And a real prophet was passing by, and the false prophet said to him, I am a prophet just like you, and I saw an angel, and he told me, you're supposed to come to my house. Do you know that that real prophet disobeyed God because God specifically told that real prophet, do not eat in that land? You're not supposed to eat with someone who's committing idolatry. Don't go into Hindu restaurants. Don't go into Chinese restaurants. Don't go into a Catholic restaurant that has a Mary there. You're not supposed to eat with people who are offering their food to idols. And the Northern Kingdom was. And this prophet was told, don't eat in that territory. Come home. And because this false prophet told him that, he died. Because he disobeyed a direct commandment from Yah himself. False prophets will get you in trouble. I've got to figure out how I'm going to wrap this up. I'm going to go ahead and read this episode from Acts chapter 8. Now when the Shlichim, I'm in verse 14, when the Shlichim at Yerushalayim heard that the Samaritan people had accepted the word of Elohim, mind you, this is the territory of Ephraim and Dan, Samaria. Everybody with me? Are y'all okay? Do I need to send you home? They had accepted the word of Elohim. They sent to them Shimon, Kepha, Peter, and Yohanan, John, who when they went down, prayed over them that they might receive the Ruach HaKodesh. For as yet it had not come upon them, although they had been immersed in the name of Adonainu Yeshua. You can be immersed in the name of Adonainu Yeshua and not have the power of the Ruach HaKodesh. I hope everyone in here has that power. That's why we immerse regularly once a year. And if you need it, if you just got to have it before then, if we counsel you and we decide that you're ready, we will immerse you. And I promise you, you will receive the power. It may or may not manifest that day. How many of you, when you were immersed in the proper way, received power to walk this life? When they laid their hands on them, they received the Ruach HaKodesh. And Shimon, a different Shimon, saw the Ruach HaKodesh was given by the laying on of hands by the Shlichim, and he offered them money, saying, give me also this authority, so that on whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Ruach HaKodesh. Why? He wanted to pay for it. It was an investment. He wanted to make money off of it. Shimon Kepha said to him, let your money perish with you because you have thought that the gift of Elohim may be purchased with wealth. You have no part nor lot in this faith because your heart is not right in the sight of Elohim. He was not interested in giving people what they need to live a righteous life. The Ruach HaKodesh is not so that we can all run around like flames on fire and demonstrate spiritual power. That's not what the Ruach HaKodesh is given for. The Ruach HaKodesh is given to correct you when you're wrong and to give you power to walk a righteous life. And that is what a real prophet is interested in giving people the power they need to live righteously. If it manifests in an unknown language or in an ability to heal people or in an ability to prophesy, hallelujah! But the greater goal is to give people the ability to be righteous so that they can leave in the Netzal. So that they can be rescued from their sin right now. So, I'm going to try to wrap up here. So, I've talked about so far the gift of tongues and the gift of prophecy. And these are sort of the opposite ends of the spectrum, from here to here, okay? And Shaul, in teaching about this, he instructs the Corinthians that the tongues is the least. It's the least of the gifts. It's not that important. Prophecy is the most important. And prophecy lifts people up and builds people up. Prophecy is not just foretelling future events. Again, a real prophet preaches repentance and turns people's hearts. That's what prophecy is. And it is accompanied by the other powers of the Ruach HaKodesh at times, not always. So I'm going to give some testimony about ways that false anointing, if you will, affected my life at times and this body. But I'm going to say this first, because if you notice, when Moshe came as a prophet, as the first and greatest of the prophets until Yochanan, when Moshe came, that his goal was to unite Israel, and the miracles that he did were done on Egypt as judgment. And it was also for the purpose, remember Israel went through the first three plagues, and it was get them to a point where they believe that Yah is Elohim, just like Eliyahu. Get them to where Yah is Elohim. And it took the first three plagues to do that to Israel. And then after that, all of it was poured out on Mitzrayim. The power of the Ruach HaKodesh in the sense of fire from heaven is to get rid of flesh. And that's effectively what happened at Shavuot when those 3,000 people were there and the 500 were there first, and on the 500 the Ruach HaKodesh, it changed them. It burned away flesh and they began to declare the praises of Elohim in all the known languages of the day. And did you notice that the 5,000, 3,000 or more that came that day, it doesn't say that they spoke in tongues. It wasn't necessary. Are you with me? So if we look back at the tabernacle, this anointing oil is the Ruach HaKodesh. And again, it's to set us apart. So I have seen personally all manners of so-called manifestations of the Spirit. But I've also experienced very real manifestations that could not be anything other than God. And I myself have been deceived by false manifestations of the Spirit. And if you're honest with yourself, you'll admit that you've been deceived too. If you're honest. But in regard to prophecy, this is what a false prophet likes to do. I had a false prophet who I worshiped with for over a year. And I loved him. I thought he was a brother. But over and over in the short time that I was in that congregation, and this is long before Bat Zion existed or was even started, over and over and over throughout the year or so of us being there, he would push other people out of the way and put me in their place. And I hated it. One of the guys was his youth minister who was dying. And this guy took great joy in being the youth minister. And that's the one that sent me off the edge. I was like, you have got to be kidding me. You're going to push this guy out of the way because he's dying when this is probably giving them the most joy that he has ministering to these kids. And I called him and I said, I can't do this. There's no love in this congregation. And I told him, I'm leaving. And he prophesied to me that day. And he said, in the name of the Lord, in 1 year, if you leave, in 1 year, your life will be destroyed. It wasn't last year. It was 19 years ago. 16. I knew it was a false prophecy. And it was about 6 or 8 years later when the guy called me Hasatan from the pulpit because he found out I was beginning to go messianic, building a messianic congregation. I guess he thought I was competition. I don't want your people. Not until they convert. We've had people come into this congregation who claim that they have the Holy Spirit and they think that we don't. And some of them lived here and abode with us and had the feast with us for several years and claimed that all the other children at Batzion were evil because they didn't speak in tongues and have the gift of the Holy Spirit. And then when their children come up pregnant out of wedlock, they have to leave. Most of you don't know that because we don't run our mouths about people. And you're sitting there going over your memory trying to figure out who it is. You probably won't. They were ashamed of themselves that they so boldly implied that our children didn't have the Ruach. And you look around at the children in this room, and they're not perfect. And I'm talking from toddlers all the way to teenagers. I see joy, love, peace, kindness, meekness, self-control. I don't need my kids to tie my bow tie. A Navi is a spokesperson. A prophet is a vessel. A prophet knows he's not important. A prophet doesn't go around saying, I'm a prophet. He doesn't need to. He doesn't want to. Most prophets die for the faith. Elkanah had his head cut off. All the shlichim were murdered. All the prophets in the Old Testament were murdered. It's not a cake and gravy life. And if you want to be a prophet, here's what Abba says. Serve this body. If you want the gift of prophecy, serve the body. A prophet is a servant first. God doesn't save a person and zap him and make him a prophet. You look at most prophets in the scriptures and they were old men. Do you realize that? Most, not all, but most of them were old men. Because they had learned they ain't superheroes. And they understood that only God gets glory for anything that he does. He says, I will share my glory with no one. And the moment that a prophet says, I am a prophet, look at me. I'm sorry I kept you so long. It's Matt's fault. I guess in closing, my last words will be, keep your eyes open, and when you're reading the scriptures, look at your own heart. Stop thinking about everybody else when you see the scriptures of correction. Because I promise you, I told the men in the class this morning, I was reading one of the imprecatory psalms. It's the prayers. We read the prayers on a regular basis in this congregation. And imprecatory means against the enemy. And I was reading that and I realized, you know what? These enemies that I'm reading about are right here inside of me. This is where the enemies are, is in my soul. This is where Hasatan has a heyday, is inside every one of us. And it's until we recognize that and desire that Elohim help us cast out the enemy. And I'm not talking about demon possession. I'm just talking about elements of sin that are still left in us. Get it out. And if we want to see Elohim, because we have, at these times of prayer, we have had God manifest. Again, we're just not putting on a show and banging a drum about it. But if we want to see people delivered It takes first that they come. When you come up here, if you want something from God, come up here with repentance in mind. What have I done to bring this situation into my life? And it's not blame on you. It's taking personal responsibility for who you are in God and for the sanctity of this house. And like I said, we have situations going on right now in this body that are affecting the whole body, and you're not aware of it. I know it's been long today, but I'm asking you, if prayer happens this morning, and I don't want you to come up here just because you want to be seen that you need prayer. And I've tried to instruct you that this moment is for serious time in critical needs in the body. Not, you know, my dog needs a bath, or, you know, I can't figure out what to cook for dinner, or, you know. Are you with me? Come up here with a heart of repentance, and if you're not praying for the ones who are standing here, if you're just looking around, you're dead weight. I prefer you leave. But the more that stay here and pray for whatever's going on here, the more we will see things get done. And if our hearts, just like Matthew said, if our heart is right, God will respond. I better shut up. 67.
Aleinu nishabech la'adon hakol, batet hidulah li'otzeh bereshit. It is our duty to praise the Master of all, to ascribe greatness to the molder of creation. For he has not made us like the nations of the lands, and has not placed us like families of the earth. For he has not assigned our portion like theirs, nor our fate like all their prowess. For they bow down to vanity and emptiness, and pray to a God who does not save. But we kneel and bow and acknowledge our thanks before the King who reigns over kings, the Holy One. He stretches out heaven and establishes earth. The seat of his glory is in the heavens above, and his powerful presence is in the loftiest heights. He is our Elohim, and there is none other. True is our King. There is nothing beside him. As it is written in his Torah, you shall know today and take it back to your heart that Yahweh is the only Elohim in heaven above and on earth below. There is none other. And it is said, Yahweh will be king over all the world. On that day, Yahweh will be one, and his name will be one.
Blessed are you, O Yahweh, our Elohim, who has given us this.
living word, Messiah.
Yevarechecha Yehua v'yishmarecha Ya'er Yehua panav alecha v'chunecha Yisa Yehua panav alecha v'yasim lecha Shalom. May Yahuwah bless you and keep you. May Yahuwah make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May Yahuwah lift up his countenance upon you and establish for you shalom. Hashem Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. Shabbat shalom.